Hi, I'm Ryan Baker, and I'd like to welcome you to the Data Science Methods for Digital Learning Platform Certificate. We're really excited to welcome you to the Certificate in Data Science Methods for Digital Learning Platforms. Our mission is to provide learners with hands-on experiences in understanding and applying a range of intermediate and advanced data science methods on data from real digital learning platforms, as well as space to develop your professional identity in equity-oriented data science. Over the last 15 years, the educational data mining and learning analytics communities have developed a range of algorithms tailored to the data and R&D goals of digital learning platforms. The Data Science Methods for Digital Learning Platform Certificate is going to provide you with a breadth and a depth of skills that expand beyond existing courses of its length in data science or in education more generally. It's exciting to be working with such a great cohort. We've carefully handpicked the best applicants to the program, looking at career interests, past experiences, and preparation. We've all been blown away by how many applications we received, like many times more than we have space for, and your cohort are the very best and brightest, and we're honored to be teaching you. So that's where you are. Where we hope you'll be at the end is that you'll be prepared to become an education researcher capable of leveraging large-scale data using data science methods to augment education quality using digital learning platforms. All of you are already just one step away from this, and our goal is to get you the whole way by the end of this program. Now, I'd be remiss to not mention a little bit about digital learning platforms and what they are. There's been a recent explosion of digital learning platforms being used at scale in K-12 and undergraduate learning in the U.S., and this provides richer and richer data on richer and richer interactions between the students and the learning platforms. A few examples are shown here. On the top left, Conmigo, a system based on natural language dialogue and large language models built by Khan Academy that can engage with students in dialogues on math, English language arts, and other subjects. On the top right, Mathia, a platform used at scale both in K-12 and in undergraduate, which breaks down the complex procedure of mathematics problem solving into more bite-wise pieces, and then provides on-demand hint and feedback to students as they're working through it, while tracking their knowledge to see if they've mastered it. At the bottom left, InKits, a learning platform that teaches students how to conduct scientific inquiry, detects whether their scientific inquiry is effective, and gives them automated feedback based on their scientific inquiry, also their engagement or disengagement. At the bottom right, QThink. QThink is a learning platform for mathematics where students are scaffolded based on theoretical models of self-regulated learning to plan their learning, to plan their problem solving, and then are given the opportunity to actually solve the problem in video thinklets, and then they critique each other. Students critique each other, give each other feedback, revise their solutions, get automated feedback on those revisions, and finally it all goes to the teacher. So these are just a few examples of the richness of digital learning platforms used today in the United States. In this certificate, you'll learn a range of different methods for exploring the data and exploiting the data that comes out of these platforms involving data science, learning analytics, educational data mining. Now, a quick note, since many of you are trained in statistics, data science and statistics are closely allied fields, and sometimes there's subtle differences in what the same terminology means, and we'll try to flag these for those of you with a statistics background. Just keep in mind that sometimes words might not mean what you think they should mean. It's unfortunate, but the two communities kind of came from different roots to some degree, and so they sometimes use different words to mean the same thing, and the same words to mean different things. Especially with digital learning platforms, we're often dealing with large quantities of data. It's sometimes called quote-unquote big data, but there's always a debate about what big data really is. Many traditional statistical paradigms break down at this size. Everything comes up statistically significant, even with tiny, trivial effect sizes. And some stats tools are just too slow with this much data. Many of the concerns of statistics are still very relevant. Many of the methods are drawn from statistics, especially in recent years, but that doesn't mean they're exactly the same. There's been porous boundaries between fields. They nonetheless still kind of remain different fields. In data science and education itself, there's been two communities that have sprung up. The first is the International Educational Data Mining Society. Its first event was a workshop in 2005 at what at the time was called the American Association for Artificial Intelligence. I now think it's called the Association for Advancement in Artificial Intelligence. The first conference held by the community was Educational Data Mining 2008 in Montreal, and we've been publishing the Journal of Educational Data Mining since 2009. The other one is the Society for Learning Analytics Research, which held its first conference in, I believe, Canada in 2011, and had the Journal of Learning Analytics, which was founded in 2012. These two communities have the joint goal of exploring the, again, quote-unquote, big data now available on learners and learning, to promote new scientific discoveries and advance the science of learning, to better assess learners along multiple dimensions, including cognitive, metacognitive, emotional, social, and so on, and to create better real-time support for learners, including both adaptive learning systems, digital learning platforms that actually adapt, and to create actionable information for teachers and other school personnel that they can use to make decisions to help improve student outcomes. There's a range of types of educational data mining and learning analytics methods, and we're going to get into some of them in this certificate program, but not all of them. Some of them include prediction modeling with kind of four key types: classification, predicting binary or categorical data; regression, predicting a number; latent knowledge estimation, where you're trying to predict students' knowledge from their performance; and sequential classifiers, like what we see in large language models, that predict not just one event, but a sequence of future events. Second big category, structure discovery. Structure discovery is when we take a large data set and just try to find out what kind of information just falls out of the data set. This includes things like clustering, where you try to group data points together. It includes factor analysis, where you try to group variables together. It includes domain structure discovery, aka discovering in a group of skills or items which ones are prerequisite to other ones. It includes network analysis, including famously social network analysis. And it includes epistemic network analysis, which is a subcategory of network analysis focused on understanding the relationships between coded elements in qualitative data. A third big category is relationship mining, trying to find the relationship between variables. This includes association rule mining, probably the most classic form in data science, which involves figuring out if-then rules from data, not necessarily causal ones. That's seen in causal data mining, a different category. Correlation mining, that is looking for variables that correlate to each other in large sets of data. And sequential pattern mining, that tries to find rules that apply over time. Fourth big category, according to these reviews, is visualization. And a fifth big category is discovery with models, where we build a model using prediction or structure discovery, and then we use it as a component in future analyses. In prediction modeling, you develop a model which can infer a single aspect of the data, the predicted variable, from some combination of other aspects of the data, the predictor variables. And this can include things like which students are off task, or which students are on track to fail the class. Again, in structure discovery, you find structure and patterns in the data that emerge, quote-unquote, naturally. There's no specific target or predictor variable you're looking for. You're just looking for what falls out of the data, whether it be clusters of data points, or factors in your variables, or structure in your skills, or networks. In relationship mining, discovering relationships between variables in a data set with a whole lot of variables. And there are, again, several forms of relationship mining. Discovery of models, pre-existing model developed with some other method, applied to data and uses a component in another analysis. So I've kind of repeated myself a little here, but just want to make sure that these were all familiar to you folks. We're going to go through a bunch of these over the course of the certificate program. So across the weeks of the certificate program, here's the outline. This week, introduction, challenges, and framework. We're kind of going to set the groundwork for the rest of the program. Next week, prediction modeling and metrics. We'll go into kind of a deep dive on the methods of prediction modeling, most notably classification and regression, and how we evaluate if a model is any good. We'll also talk about how to not do it wrong. We'll then go on to discuss feature extraction and feature engineering. These digital learning platforms have very complex data, and it's often not in an organized, easy-to-use fashion when you first get it, so you have to turn that into variables that can be meaningfully input into prediction modeling or other approaches, and that's what this week we'll talk about. In our following week, we'll talk about the recent advances in neural networks and deep learning, notably for sequential classification, but also for other forms of prediction modeling as well. We'll continue on with a switch to talking about data visualization. We'll then talk about an incredibly key topic, ethics, equity, and algorithmic bias. We'll move on to discuss data management and database access, which is really important because most digital learning platforms these days store their data in databases and conduct sophisticated management procedures. In this week, you'll learn how to get that data back out and how to get it in there in the right way in the first place. We'll then move on to a structure discovery topic, knowledge graphs, where we'll discuss how you create knowledge graphs relating skills to each other and how you refine them to make them better based on data. We'll go on from there to another form of prediction modeling. We're kind of discussing prediction modeling throughout the course because there's so many different ways it applies. And this week, we'll discuss knowledge tracing, which is, again, measuring student knowledge as it changes in a digital learning platform from their performance. We'll go on from there to talk about data and measurement validity, key to kind of all the topics we're talking about in this program. And from there, move to the structure discovery topic of cluster analysis. We'll go from there to talk about network analysis, and then sequential pattern mining and related temporal analysis methods. We'll move from there to causal reasoning and causal data mining. Have a week on the specifics necessary to think about these topics in the context of natural language processing. And finally, we'll conclude with a week on transformer and foundation models that will kind of bring together how these new methods, like large language models, really transform the practice of a lot of these things. So that's a lot of stuff to cover, so stay with us, but I think it's going to be fun and we're going to learn a lot together. Now, these 17 topics, which cover quite a lot of stuff, it was too much for us here at Penn or Florida to cover by ourselves, so we've brought together a group of great experts from around the country. Some of the brightest people about these topics on this or any other planet. And I'm really excited to learn together with you and all these folks as they each talk about their specialties. This is a fast-moving area. We've got a lot to cover. We're going to be covering it fast. There's been rapid advancements in methods. And that's been particularly true very recently with the emergence and rapid improvement in large language models and other forms of generative AI. It's an exciting time to be in science. Honestly, it's one of the two most exciting parts of my entire career. I'm excited to explore it together with you. So it's a lot to cover, but don't worry, we've got a plan. Over the next few weeks, here's what you should be thinking of doing. First of all, for every week, we're going to have videos. Please watch the videos. Don't skip the videos. That's like the heart of the material. If you skip the videos, you'll be missing the best part. After you've watched the videos, you'll have scaffolded hands-on learning tasks to do, mostly in the assessments platform, although I've heard that a couple of my colleagues might be using other platforms, or just no platform at all. After that, we'll have discussion forums moderated by the week's expert. Now, you can post those discussion forums while you're watching the videos, or while you're doing the hands-on tasks. Don't be shy to participate and to get into conversations with your fellow learners and with the instructors. There will also be reflective journals where you can think of and consolidate what you're doing and think about how it relates to your own current and upcoming practice. And finally, we'll have live Ask Me Anything sessions with every expert where you can literally ask them anything about the week's materials or other subjects that come to your mind. We'll also have surveys to track how we're doing. Now, these are totally optional. You're not required to do them, but please answer them. It'll help us make this better and figure out if we're getting this right. We know that we've always got a lot to improve on. We're learning scientists, and that means that we care about your learning as well as the learning of the people we study in our formal research. So please answer the surveys if you can. So finally, let's talk about this week. This week is a warm-up week. In this week, we're going to have activities that focus on getting to know us and each other, and on making sure that you're ready to do the activities in future weeks. Things like getting the tools infrastructure set up, learning how to use assessments, getting Python working for everybody. It's going to get a little more intense in the weeks to come. Let's face it, this is an intensive certificate program. But don't stress out. We're all here to help. We're going to be involved. We're going to be engaged. We're going to be working with you. So again, welcome. We're extremely glad to have you here. Thank you for being here.